lights aren't out. The house lights weren't out. Glad to get out of here by 11? At least. Can we try it again, please? Can you concentrate on what you're doing? A little concentration. Now fade the lights, and when you fade them, almost total darkness. And don't go so fast. Now you stop right there and slowly come up. Slowly come up. All right, now you go down again slowly. Why are we dimming the lights, Timmy? Do you know? That's right. So if they're talking, start to come up, they have a chance to go back to where they're sitting. Are the work lights on? Those are the stage lights? Okay, there's a short in the system. All right, at least we know what's going on. All right, it's a short in the system.
Mr. Dondero?
Yes?
There's some noise coming out of the
patch pad. Now, stand away from it so if it blows up, you don't get hurt.
Got it.
Okay, let's go. Third time, Jimmy. Let's go down. This is it. This is it, John. Okay, the lights were still a little too fast, but it was all right, it was better. Good morning, Rhoda.
Morning, Daddy.
Up and dressed and ready for the day? Wearing your best perfume?
Yes, I am, Daddy.
That's right. This is the day of the picnic. I hope there's a breeze off the water.
Miss Spark says there always is.
She says it never rains on the first day of June, too. Don't count on it.
Are you leaving today, Daddy?
My plane goes in an hour. Back to Washington and the Pentagon and a climate that coddles eggs.
I like coddled eggs.
You like everything. You're just too good to be true. Sealed orders, darling. All I know is I'll be home as soon as I can. Now, what will you give me if I give you a basket of kisses?
I'll give you a basket of hugs.
I like your hugs.
I like your kisses too, Dad. You're so big and strong.
I'll miss you. The general doesn't have one pretty girl on his whole staff.
I wish you didn't have my daddy. I'll miss you every day.
Will you write to me?
Do you want me to?
Of course I want you to.
Then I'll write to you every day.
Every time I write to Mother, I'll put in a note. Really and truly. And every time the general tells a good joke, I'll send you an official report.
Oh, Daddy, that won't be very often. You better send me the bad ones, too.
Sweetheart, I will. I shall write daily to both my sweethearts. Unless someone makes a mistake, it starts a shooting war, and we all have to go underground.
Would you go underground if there was a war?
Yes, I would. And by gum, I'd go fast.
You said by gum, because I
was. That's right, I did.
Darling, take care.
I will. Every minute I'm away. I'll wire you the minute I'm on the ground. Take care of each other, you two.
We will.
Then you.
Oh, that must be Martha and Emery. They want to say a last goodbye to you, too.
Oh, sure.
Is it all right?
It's perfect, darling. Bows and all.
Just in case the neighbors from upstairs, darling, have to be in on everything, have no lives of their own, so they live other people's. I speak for my brother as well as myself, because he never gets a chance to speak when I'm around. There, I've talked enough. Say something, Colonel.
I guess it will have to be goodbye because the taxi's here and I don't want to rush through half traffic.
Don't worry about your two pretty girls, Ken. We'll keep an eye on them. And if anything goes wrong, we'll send up smoke signals.
I'm counting on you, Emery. And on Monica.
Goodbye, Kenneth.
Well, sweetheart, this is it. Goodbye, big eyes.
Goodbye, Daddy.
I promised myself I wouldn't cry, but I can't seem to help it.
Don't, sweet. It's just another empty month or two. We'll get through it somehow.
I'll take these. Yes, I'm pretty early, Mrs. Penmark, but it's my day for doing windows on this side.
Okay, Leroy, you can begin in the bedroom.
Excuse me, ma'am. Morning.
I like garnets, but I like turquoise better. You sound just like Fred Astaire tap-tapping across the room. What have you got on your shoes?
I run over my heels. Somebody had these iron pieces put on so they last longer.
I'm afraid I can't take any credit. It was Rose's idea entirely.
I think they're very nice, and they save money, too.
Oh, you penurious little sweetheart! But I'll tell you one thing, Rhoda. I think you worry too much when you're not the best at everything. That's why Emery and I thought you should have some presents today. You really wanted that penmanship medal very much, didn't you?
It's the only gold medal this firm gives, and besides, it was really mine. Everybody knew I wrote the best in, and I shouldn't have had it.
Excuse me, I have to get some water.
I just don't see why Claude dangled up the medal.
Rhoda, these things happen sometimes, and when they do, we simply accept them. I've told you to forget the whole thing. I'm sorry, I know you don't like people pouring over you.
But it was mine, the medal was mine!
Rhoda, now forget it, the whole thing out of your mind!
I won't!
Rhoda, now listen to me.
Leroy, have you completely lost your senses? You spilled water on Rhoda's shoes!
I'm sorry, I guess I was just trying to hurry.
Leroy!
I'm sorry, Miss Breedlove.
Leroy, I own this apartment house. I employ you. I've tried to give you the benefit of every doubt because you have a family. I thought of you as emotionally immature, torn by irrational raging, a bit on the psychopathic side. But after this demonstration, I can see that my diagnosis was entirely too mild. You're definitely a schizophrenic with paranoid overtones. I've had quite enough of your discourtesy and your silliness, and so have the tenants in this apartment building. My brother Emery has wanted to discharge you, but I've been on your side with misgivings. I shall protect you no longer.
Monica, it was an accident. I'm sure it was. He didn't mean it.
He meant to do it. I know Leroy well. It was no accident, Christine. It was deliberate. The spiteful act of a neurotic child.
He meant to do it. I was looking at you when you made up your mind to do it. I was looking at you when you made up your mind to wet us.
No. I'm just clumsy.
Oh, Leroy, please. My patience is at an end, and you might as well know it. Go about your work.
Yes, ma'am.
He has the mind of a 9-year-old, but he has managed to produce a family, so I keep him on. Oh, that'll be Miss Fern.
Yes, come in, Miss Fern. We're nearly ready, I think.
I'll get ahead of time, as usual.
Oh, Miss Fern! This old scatterbrain. I left my 2 dozen cupcakes upstairs. Rhoda, will you help me carry them down?
Yes, of course I will.
They're all packed.
Good morning, Miss Fern. That's a perfect curtsy, Rhoda.
Thank you, Miss Fern. She does such things well.
She does everything well. You must know better than I.
And as a person, does she fit in well at the school?
Let me think. In what way, Mrs. Penmore?
Well, I don't know quite how to put this, but there's a mature quality about Rhoda that's disturbing in a child. And my husband and I felt that at a school like yours, where you believe in discipline and the old-fashioned virtues, you might perhaps teach her how to be a bit more of a child.
Yes, I know what you mean. In some ways, in many ways, Rhoda is the most satisfactory teacher the school has ever had. She's never been absent. She's never been tardy. She's the only child in the history of the school who's made 100 in beat quarterly each month and 100 in self-reliance and conservation every month for a full school year. You have dealt with as many children as I have. You realize what a remarkable record that is. She's the neatest little girl I
like her? Is she popular?
Yeah, the children well. She's
here
like,
we are.
And I suppose we should go. Must have been any other to be waiting. Goodbye, Mrs. Kenmore.
Goodbye, Miss Fern, and may it be everything a picnic should be.
Thank you. Come, Rhoda. Yes, Miss Fern.
Come, she's a prosperous voyage.
Thank you. We'll take care of her. No time. We what?
We stole time, didn't we, Rhoda?
Bless you both.
So, now the older set's left behind with nothing to do.
I suppose I could go through the dreary business of making my face presentable. It happens every morning.
Your face? Think of mine.
It always makes me gloomy when Kenneth goes away. Anything could happen before I see him again. There's an old saying, we die a little at parting.
My dear, we die a little every day if we want to sit and brood about it. I know. You're having Emery and Reggie Tash for the lunch. Can I help with that?
What do you feed a criminologist?
Oh, arsenic, formaldehyde, crushed glass.
Oh, hot weather things.
Nothing would hurt Reggie. He thrives on buckets of blood and sudden death.
How many mysteries has he written?
Well, a complete set of his works would encircle the Empire State Building. Or me. Come on, I'm a gal in this old hag, but I can crush glass. We're not going to let you be lonely.
She don't think nobody knows anything but her. I'll show that bitch plenty. And that young trout bed, Mrs. Penrod. She doesn't get enough of what she needs. Give it to her.
But I did mean it. Nobody ever believes me when I tell them I met Seaman Floyd.
Come now, they believe you.
You mean it's automatic, flattery. They know I'm old enough, but they voiced out just to make me feel better.
Right, take the book from you and read it. Take it from me.
Well, anyway, it wasn't Dr. Floyd who acted right. It was Dr. Kettlebell, didn't it?
Now we're off.
And this was my choice, too.
That's even better. Get up to the point and say, now we're off.
Not that I minimize Freud's professional standing, for I still consider him the great genius of our time. But Dr. Kettlebell was more simpatico, if you know what I mean, Reggie.
It's me, simpatico, if you know what that means.
Freud loathes American women.
Oh?
Especially the ones that talk back to him. And I loathed Freud's dramatic prejudice against feminine independence, which he couldn't be concealed.
Was
Freud prejudiced? Indeed he was, not consciously though. He just bristled when I suggested that women had far much more sense than men. Now Dr. Kettlebell believed in the power of the individual soul and considered sex of only trivial interest. His mind was less literal.
Oh, Monica, really? Did the analysis do you any good, actually?
Well, it broke up right now. I look at the very bottom of myself. What a spectacle! Anyway, when I came back, I asked Mr. Reba for his voice, and he didn't oppose it. So then I decided that what I'd always really wanted was to make a home for my brother, Emery, which I did. But I don't think dear Emery appreciates it. But what woman
I can stand anything except you analyze me, your friends, and me. I don't want to look into the bottom of my soul.
I can understand that perfectly. We're all so sensitive about these things. The truth absolutely disgusts us. Now, I've come to the conclusion that Emery is a law-abated homosexual.
What?
Thank you. What does law-abated mean?
It means covered, as with a mask.
It means something that hasn't come to the surface as yet.
Well, if I'm a law-abated homosexual, they'll have to change the whole concept of what goes on in the moment.
Where did you get that idea, Monica?
Pure association. The best evidence of all. Emery is 52 years
house, like murder? Does anybody mind if I smoke a cigarette?
What are you trying to prove, Emery?
All right, let's relax and have our tea.
Yes, we want good sex. Let's try homicide. Reggie, you're the expert.
You know, any change is for the better. Digging at people's insides. You're nothing but a ghoul.
Of course. Who is it? Furnish the final details, Reggie.
Well, Miss Allison hurried back to town on an urgent errand. She had to pay the current premium on Shirley's life. And it was the last day of grace.
Stupid.
But she was certainly crude. But there have been artists in her line. Really gifted operators. Like Bessie Denton. Bessie never made a mistake. Never left a trace. Never committed an imperfect crime.
Who was this?
Most amazing woman in all annals of homicide, Bessie Denton. She was beautiful, she was brainy, and she was ruthless. She never used the same poison twice. Her own father, for example, died of rabies. Supposedly contracted from a mad dog. It's just that old funny thing, Bessie.
Did you say Bessie Denton?
Yes.
Excuse me. I think that I...
I think Christine has had enough of this. Couldn't we talk about something else, Reggie?
We certainly could.
And we will, though I'm still puzzled.
No. Tell us more about Dr. Kettlebaum.
No. Monica has three things on her mind. Sex, psychiatry, and pills. Sex and psychiatry are synonymous. You'd better try pills.
By pills, Emery means the modern pharmaceutical discoveries, which have revolutionized medicine.
I should have looked at this before. I have a lecture date at 3:30, and I won't be a bit ahead of time if I leave now. You forgive me, Miss Penlock, for filling the air with such horror stories.
You must forgive me, Mr. Tasker. I have a phobia or a mania when I hear such things.
I'm sick of the bloody stuff myself, and I only keep with it to make a living. So let's be friends.
Yes, of course.
I do have to go. Goodbye, Monica.
Goodbye, Phoebe.
Well, goodbye, Reggie. See you Sunday. I hear the bluefish are running.
Oh, good.
Yeah, I would say it'd be about time for the news. Do you mind, Christine?
Oh, of course not. I'll just stand before. I'll lend a hand. Nothing more important has happened for many years in the field of foreign affairs. I interrupt this broadcast, too. I have been asked to announce that one of the children on the annual outing of the Fern Grammar School was accidentally drowned in the bay this afternoon. The name of the victim is being withheld until the parents are first notified. More news of this tragic affair is expected momentarily.
It was not Rhoda. It was some timid, confused youngster, afraid of its own shadow. Rhoda is still something like a child. It certainly wasn't Rhoda.
This is Station WNB in Tallahassee, bringing you the 3:15 news, brought to you by Piggott's Hardware, best for your home needs. To return to local affairs, I am now authorized to give the name of the victim of the drowning at the Fern School picnic. It was Claude Daigle, the only child of Mr. and Mrs. Dwight Daigle of 126 Willow Street. He appears to have fallen into the water from an abandoned wharf on the Fern property. It is a mystery. How the little boy got on the wharf, for all the children had been forbidden to play near or on it. But his body was found off the end of a landing, wedged among the piling. The guards who brought up the body applied artificial respiration, without result. There were bruises on the forehead and hands, but it is assumed these were caused by his body washing against the piling. And now back to the national news.
Oh, that poor child. That poor little boy.
They'll send the children home immediately. They must be on their way now.
This will be the end of the picnic.
Monica, I don't know what to say to her. Rhoda's only 9. I remember I didn't even know about death at that age. Or it didn't touch me closely. A teacher I adored died once. My whole world changed and darkened.
Oh, we'd better go. This is no time for well-meaning friends to look in from the sidelines.
Monica, I don't know what to say to her.
You'll face it better alone. Honestly, you will.
Yes, you will, dear. We better go. Thank you, Monica. Thank you, Emily. Oh, I suppose she didn't have a sandwich. I'll make her one.
We'll be upstairs in case you need us.
Thank you again.
Darling, you're controlling yourself very well.
I'll give you a basket of hugs.
I want to go and see Mommy after.
Then you should, dear. Go ahead.
How come you're going skating and enjoying yourself while your school friend is still down from the drowning in the bay? Looks like to me you'd be in the house crying.